Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
And welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
And I'm Sam Simpson. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Now here's how it works. There's teachers in Dallas, teachers standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
If you would like help with your homework, dial Dollar Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
Now you can also send us your questions on our website. Go to homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Yak Back button and send in your questions.
Before we get to our first question tonight, we want to remind our viewers that a little later in the show today, and Tim will, from the Seneca Park Zoo will be here.
Hi, Tim. All right, now it's Tuesday, and that means it's time for our creature teaser.
This creature is very defensive and has an attack first and ask questions later attitude. When it smells something unfamiliar, it will charge. It does not have a very good eyesight and will sometimes run into trees or rocks, thinking that they are threats. On its nose are two horns that it uses to fight.
All right, now the horns are made from a substance similar to our fingernails, so if they break, they can grow back. Mothers also use their horns to protect their babies from lions, crocodiles, and other predators. And the babies will often stay with their mothers for years, learning how to survive independently. Now, when a sibling is born, usually after more than 2 years, this creature is ready to live on its own.
If you think you can solve our creature teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904, or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly, and you could have a chance to share that answer at the end of the show.
But remember, every correct response goes into our Hotline Hall of Fame, and if you earn enough points, you can win a tablet at the end of the season. All right.
Okay.
Now, Sam, you have an email question for us.
Yes, I do.
All right. Math, too, right?
Yep.
All right.
Let's move over to the board. Let's see if we can work on that. This particular question says, which of the following equations has a solution of 2? Now, often you'll get these type of questions on Common Core or Regents exams. And the question becomes, okay, how do I do this? These are the ones that you're going to have to plug that answer in to all of the equations to see which one gives you the correct answer. Now, you can try them all, or if you're a lucky guesser, you might can guess the first one correctly. Let's take x is equal to 2 and plug it into each of our equations. If I plug it into the first one, I'm going to replace the x value with 2. And I'm going to evaluate this. 2 times 2 is 4. 4 minus 3. I know 4 minus 3 is 1, and I know that that's not 19. So I know number 1 is not the correct answer. Let's try number 2, or B. If I plug in x is equal to 2, I replace that x with 2. 4 times 2 is 8. This is a tricky one. This will confuse a lot of students. 8 minus 4 is 4. But notice, 4 is not equal to negative 4. So B is also not the correct response. Let's take a look at number C, or letter C. If I'm going to plug in 2 for x once again, 3 times 2 is 6. And guess what? 6 plus 2 is indeed 8. This is our correct response. So remember, if you have problems like this, what you're going to need to do is plug in your expression for, in this case, 2, into all of the equations to see which one gives you the correct answer. We hope that helps you.
said, hey, hey.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
All right, Sam, we have another email question, so I'm going to the board. Put part of it up already.
Very good.
And it was a conversion question, all right? And it's converting Celsius to Fahrenheit, all right? It says convert 35 Celsius to Fahrenheit. Now, there's a formula for that. The formula is that the Fahrenheit temperature would be equal to 9/5 of the Celsius temperature plus 32. Now, what I always do, sometimes you forget this formula, but the thing I always remember is that water freezes at 32 Fahrenheit, freezes at 0 Celsius, so you can play with the formula until you find, you know, what works. But here we've got the formula. Let's plug in our number. So just like the last question that Sam did, when we have our unknown, okay, and here our unknown is this Celsius temperature, that's the 35, we're going to plug it into our equation. So the Fahrenheit temperature would equal 9/5 of 35 plus the 32. And let me finish my parentheses there. So the first thing we want to do is 9/5 type, and then we add the 35. So let's do this over here. 9 times 35, because let me show you what I'm doing here. That's 35 over 1. When we're multiplying, now we have two fractions. Oop, and I wrote 39 instead of 35. All right, so let's do 9 times 35 over here on the side. So we have 35 times 9. So 5 times 9 is 45. I'll put down the 5. I'll carry my 4. 3 times 9 is 27. Plus our 4 would be 31. So 315. But we're not done. Remember, it was 9/5. So now that we've multiplied by 9, I've got to divide by 5. So let's do 315 divided by 5. So 5 won't go into 3, but it will go into 31 6 times. So 6 times 5 is 30. When I subtract, I have 1. I bring down my 5, and 5 times 6 is 3. Oh, excuse me, 5 goes into 15 3 times. Finally got it. So we've got 63 for all of this. So let's go back to our original formula. So our Fahrenheit degree would equal 63 plus 32. All right, we're not quite done yet. One last step, we'll do the addition here. So our Fahrenheit temperature would equal 3 plus 2 is 5, and 3 plus 6 is 9. Our Fahrenheit temperature would be 95 degrees. So it's saying 95 degrees Fahrenheit is the same temperature as 35 degrees Celsius. All right? Now, when you're doing these conversions, though, this is the formula for Fahrenheit to Celsius. You just flip that to go the other way. But remember, we always remember the freezing boiling point of water. Plug those into whatever formula you got and make sure that it's right if you don't remember the formula.
I said, hey, hey.
Having trouble remembering the number of days in each month? Think of this saying, 30 days hath September, April, June, and November. All the rest have 31, excepting February alone, which hath but 28 and fine, till leap year gives it 29. We'll be right back.
All right, tonight our friends from the Seneca Park Zoo are here. We have Tim and Doug.
Doug, correct.
All right, Tim's the one that's not hiding. Tell us about Doug.
Doug here is a southern three-banded armadillo, a small species of armadillo that can be found in places like Bolivia and southern Brazil.
Okay. Wow. So they're not the ones that would be normally in the U.S.
No, good thinking, though. There are armadillos which live in the United States. Those are called the nine-banded armadillo, and they're all named for the number of bands that they have in their armor here. You'll see that Doug has one, two, three bands that work like a joist to help him close up his armor. The nine-banded has nine bands altogether.
And that's kind of where their name comes from, then, right?
For many of them, yep.
Mm-hmm. What is an armadillo?
That's a really great question. Armadillos are actually part of a group of animals called xenanthrins. Huh. Xenanthrins include armadillos, sloths, and anteaters. And they're all animals that have strange joints, especially in their back. For instance, you'll notice the armadillo has strange joints, including the bands, but his whole spine is going to have these extra joints that help him to use and develop his shell here.
Oh, very cool. Now, let's talk about their habitat.
Sure.
What do you tell us a little bit about this guy?
Absolutely. So oftentimes he's found in really humid areas, but sometimes he can be also found in dry areas. Most of his habitat's actually going to be right on the edge of rainforests. So not usually into the deep rainforest itself, but on the edge or in spaces between rainforest pockets, especially dry scrubland or marshy wetlands.
All right. Well, now there's many different kinds. You talked about the one that's prevalent in the U.S. Mm-hmm. and this one. How many types is there altogether?
There's approximately 20 different species of armadillo, although depending on which biologist or conservationist, there is a little bit of conversation still about what classifies as different subspecies or species. Mm-hmm. But about 20 altogether, and most of them, or if not all of them, are found in Central and South America exclusively. So nowhere else in the world can you find armadillos.
Okay. Now, go ahead.
I was saying this armadillo is curled up in a ball. Can they all curl up in a ball?
That's a really great question. Very insightful. Not all of them. There's another three-banded armadillo, the Brazilian three-banded, as opposed to our southern three-banded friend here, and it can also curl up completely into a ball. No other can curl up completely, but almost all of them can at least hunker down or roll up slightly using their shell or covering themselves better with their shell.
All right. Now, what's this guy eat?
Oh, primarily insects, actually. He's an incredible insectivore. So he's got very few molars that don't have an enamel on them, but they're peg-like, and they help him to mush up a lot of the different termites or ants that he might like to eat. Mm-hmm. And he uses an incredible sense of hearing and sense of smell. If you look at just how much space his nose takes up on his face here, you'll see that he has a huge nose, and he can find the trails that ants and termites leave behind, and then use these great claws up here in the front to start eating them out.
I was going
to
ask, how does he eat? I see those claws there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so he's got these claws. He'll find where the ants, termites, or grubs are, undig them or unearth them using these incredible claws, and then he slurps them up with a long, sticky tongue and chews on them with those molars.
Wow. Now let's talk a little bit about human impact on this guy and other armadillos. What are humans doing?
Well, humans oftentimes will have a really negative impact in places where animals like these guys live. Unfortunately, one of the biggest causes of loss of life for armadillos is going to be incidents or road accidents. Their great defense mechanism, curling up into a ball or hunkering down in a ball, works really well for predators, but not so well with automobiles. It doesn't get them out of the way in time. So oftentimes they're found as roadkill. But even so, there's other negative impacts that we have. In fact, a really big one right now is loss of habitat as farmland encroaches on those marshes or rainforests where the armadillos live. Oftentimes they run out of places to live, or farmers don't like them unearthing their crops to get at the grubs underneath.
I see you say armor. Does that armor actually protect them from predators?
From nearly every predator, actually. Okay. So like with many adaptations, there's a little bit of an arms race between prey and predator species. So he has this really incredible bony shell that covers his whole body when he curls up all the way. And it can protect him from nearly every predator, with the exception of some who have really great adaptations, like jaguars. Actually, a creature teaser from last time. The jaguars have an incredibly powerful bite and a really large jaw gape, it's called. So they can sometimes, with time and patience, use their jaws and get around the armadillo and eventually crush the shell. Fortunately, the shell is also really good camouflage. So if he just stays still or uses his ears or nose to detect the predator before it gets there, he's oftentimes protected before he even needs the shell.
You know, and we talked earlier that he's a mammal. Mm-hmm. You know, if you look at the shell, you may look reptilian, but here we can see the hair. And let's talk a little bit.
Absolutely. So he is a mammal, and he actually is a placental mammal. So mm-hmm. they're not going to come out of eggs or yolk sacs or anything such as that. And they're not marsupials either, so the, like an opossum or a kangaroo. Mm-hmm. So they don't hang out in their mother's pouch or in their father's pouch. So their offspring will be born, and for the first few weeks, they'll hang out with their mom, drinking her milk and slowly developing. But they're born with these shells, actually. The shells are quite soft until they slowly get a little bit harder. Probably makes it a little bit easier to bear. Mm-hmm. But he does have these hairs. For him, it does help a little with thermal regulation, but especially it works as a bit of a sensor. So if there's a predator nearby, he might be able to keep his shell open just a little bit so these hairs stick out. And if a predator gets too close, he can snap close like a steel trap, scaring or startling the predator.
All right. And you talked about thermal regulation. Mm-hmm. How does now these guys like warmth. Let's talk about what does Doug do here in the winter.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. So he definitely likes the warm. And you can see he's actually shivering just a little bit to keep his extremities a little bit warmer. Mm-hmm. His favorite temperature is right around 80 degrees. So he's actually quite comfortable here in the lights of the stage. Mm-hmm. But his extremities get a little bit cooler. We actually spoke once about the duck and how the duck has special veins to help to make
the
sure that...
The countercurrent, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
He actually has the same adaptation in his arms and legs so that his legs and arms will actually be much cooler than his body temperature so that no matter what thermal fluctuations happen, all of his organs are staying the correct temperature. That does mean, though, he needs to shiver, and as soon as the temperature drops beneath 80 degrees. So he's oftentimes moving around a lot, eating lots of bugs to keep his energy up so he can shiver to keep these extremities warm.
Very cool.
You mentioned loss of habitat. Is there anything that we can do to support
absolutely armadillos? There's a whole lot of things that we can do. Actually, one of the best things we can do is eat a little bit less meat. A lot of the beef, especially, that we get comes from farms around Central and South America, which are growing in those same habitats where he's losing his habitat. So if we all eat a little less beef or meat, there's a little less demand for it, and maybe there'll be fewer farms in those areas.
I can afford to eat a little less of everything, too.
Oh, yeah, me too.
Well, thank you, Tim. Thanks for bringing Doug on with us.
Absolutely.
Yes. All right. Now, if you want... Go ahead.
If you want to know more about this animal and others like it, go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on the videos. And stay right there. We'll be right back in a second.
I said, hey, hey.
The order to solve a long division problem is divide, multiply, subtract, bring down. You can remember this order with a family: dad, mom, sister, brother.
Sam, what do you have planned for us?
Well, I've got a lesson on completing the square. Ah. It's a concept you really want to master.
All right.
I'm going to show you how to do it. Completing the square, it's a concept, a math concept, that you really start to learn now in about ninth grade. It's something that's prevalent throughout all of 9th, 10th, 11th. And it's often on a lot of the Common Core math assessments. So what you really want to do is master this. The sooner you master it, the better. An expression in the form of x squared plus bx is not a perfect square. What we want to do is add a c term to make that expression a complete square. Once you do that, you have something that looks like this. Then you can solve it by taking square roots. What you want to recognize is there's a relationship between the terms for that C value to make it a complete square. That process is called completing the square. Let's take a look. So here's what the relationship is. If you take a look at the standard form of a quadratic expression, and you take a look at the B value, and you divide the B value by 2, and you square it. That value then becomes the C value, and you have a perfect square. And here's the same thing with words. So if we had this expression, and we wanted to make it a perfect square, we take a look at the B value, which is 6. We divide it by 2. and we're going to end up squaring it. 6 divided by 2 is 3, and if we square it, we get 9. That makes this a perfect square. And a perfect square in this format can then be written as this type of an expression, where we can take the square root to solve computing the square type problems. Here are a couple of examples. So let's say we have the expression x squared plus 2x. What would I need to add to it to make that a perfect square? I want to identify the b value. B is equal to 2. What we want to do after we've identified the b value is take that value, divide it by 2, and square it. So if I take 2, divide it by 2, which I know is 1, and I square that, that becomes my c value, which I will in turn add to this expression, x squared plus 2x plus 1. Now I have made that a perfect square. If I want to take that trinomial and write it as a perfect square trinomial, I'm going to take the first term x, half of this first term, half of 2 is 1, and I have factored that perfect square trinomial. Let's take a look at another example. I have x squared, this time I have a minus expression for b. X squared minus 6x. My b this time is negative 6. If I take half of negative 6, which is negative 3, and I square it, I get 9. I'm going to add that to my expression. Now, if I want to factor that, what I'm going to do is write my first expression. Here's the easy way to remember what this term is. This term is always half of that b value. Half of that b value. Half of negative 6 is negative 3 squared. I've got a couple of more. Let's try one more. Get a little trickier. They can get harder. X squared plus 12x. So what am I going to add to make that a perfect square? What's my c value going to be? I identify my b. B is equal to 12. Half of 12 is 6. 6 squared is 36. That's my c value. X squared plus 12x plus 36. If I want to factor that trinomial, it's going to be x. Half of 12 is 6. That quantity squared. That's a perfect square trinomial. I left the last one for you to try. X squared minus 5x. Hope that helps.
Looking for an easy way to remember all 5 Great Lakes? Just think of homes. Huron, Ontario, Michigan, Erie, Superior.
All right, we have a winner on a creature
cool.
teaser. Dasan, are you there?
Yes.
Dasan, what's our answer? Dasan, what's the answer?
Black rhino.
Black
there
rhino,
go.
Very
Congratulations.
Good. All right, now how'd you know that?
Basically, the black rhinos basically have 2 horns. They're often.
Well, very cool. Now, we've got Tim here, and he's going to talk about black rhinos in a minute, but there's several different kinds of rhinos. Did you know that?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah. And do you know how they're different? We call them different colors, but they're really all pretty much close to the same color. But their lips are very different because of what they eat, you know, because they're different diets. But you did a great job. What grade are you in?
Thanks.
All right, well, you did a great job. Tim, you're going to tell us a little about black rhinos, right?
Absolutely, yeah. So like Joe said, there are lots of different rhinos all around the world. And there's actually two major rhinos in Africa, the black rhino and the white rhino. And as Joe said, they're actually named for the size of their lips or the shape of their lips. The white rhino actually comes from the Afrikaans word "wit," which means wide. They have very wide, squarish lips because they're grazers. They eat a lot of the low vegetation on the ground. The black rhino, however, with a higher stature for its head, will actually have a thin, almost hooked lip because it eats a lot of browse or a lot of the shrubs and plants that lie at about our knee level. So they use dexterous lips to pull them off. But they're all about the same color as whatever they've been rolling around in last, mostly mud.
Well, great, Tim. We thank you. We appreciate it. And congratulations. But don't forget, now, every Kirk response goes in our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Are enough points to win that tablet at the end of the season?
That's all that we have time for tonight. We're saying goodbye. But Dollar Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 tonight.
Now, tomorrow on Homework Hotline, we'll be kicking off Women's History Month with Chancellor Maloney from the University of Massachusetts Lowell. Good night.
Good night, guys.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.